Okay, so we're going to start with this very hands-on approach to testing. Testing is a thing that I have to admit, it's really just 3 or 4 years ago that I got religion about it. And what I mean by that is I always sort of, you know, I was told it was important, I believed it was important, I kind of tried to do it, but doing it this way really changed my life, and I hope it will change yours too. And no, I'm not on the presidential campaign. So let's start talking about unit tests. There's some background in the book about the different kinds of testing. We'll focus initially on unit tests and a little bit on functional tests. And as with so many things in this class, there's a handy acronym that helps us remember what good unit tests should be. So one of them is they should be fast, shouldn't take a long time to run them. They should be independent. That means that running one test before another shouldn't make any difference. The order in which you run them, they shouldn't have dependencies on each other. They should be repeatable. If a test finds a bug, it should find that bug every time. In some cases, it's easy to do this. In other cases, it's surprisingly subtle. Self-checking. What testing used to mean, not that long ago, for many companies, is software got thrown over the wall to this QA department, and then people in QA would sort of manually poke at the software and do things, and that worked. We don't do that anymore, right? The test code has to know itself if it passed or failed. No human intervention should be required to make that decision. And timely, that means that the tests should be written right around the same time the code is written. If the code changes, the tests change right away. And in fact, we're actually going to do it even more aggressive. We're going to write the tests first, before the code is written. So that's as timely as you can be. It's like time warp delivery. So what does this mean? Because if tests are fast, you know, why do you want that? Well, it's because you can run a subset of the tests all the time. If you have thousands and thousands of unit tests, which is not uncommon even in a medium-sized project, it could take, you know, a minute or two to run the entire test suite, and that really slows you down. What you want is to be able to quickly run just the tests that apply to the piece of code you're working on and not have that sort of take you out of rhythm. Independent. For that same reason, you want to be able to run any subset, and you want to be able to run them in any order. So it would be bad if there was a set of tests that only worked properly provided you ran some other tests ahead of them. Repeatable, you know, again, run it n times, get the same results. If you want to isolate bugs and enable automatic debugging, repeatability is essential. Self-checking, like I said, no human checking of the output. This means that you can sort of have tests running in the background all the time, and whenever you change something that breaks something 25 miles away in another piece of code, some tests will detect that fact and pick it up and bring it to your attention. And timely, like I said, we're going to use test-driven development where we write the tests before we write the code. So, acronym heaven. We are going to be using RSpec, which I think of as a domain-specific language for writing tests. For those of you who aren't familiar with DSLs, it's basically like a small programming language that only does a small number of things within one task domain, so it doesn't try to be general. And we've actually seen examples of them so far. Migrations are kind of a DSL, right? There's a small set of statements whose sole job is to express changes to the database schema. Now, migrations happen to be a DSL that is embedded in Ruby, meaning migrations are just Ruby code, but they're stylized to look like the tasks they do. And in fact, we'll see that RSpec is a similar example. So we'll call those an internal DSL. It's implemented inside of another language. Regular expressions are another internal DSL, right? There's like this little sub-vocabulary of things you can do in regular expressions. A different example of an external or a standalone DSL is SQL, SQL queries for databases. Right, it is its own language, and those of you who have worked with other frameworks before coming to Rails, usually what you end up doing is essentially writing SQL queries and then passing off a string to someone. Right, so that's a very clear example of dealing in different languages. So in RSpec, each test is called a spec for a specification. Surprisingly, they inhabit a directory called spec because we like to keep things simple, and there is a Rails generator, RSpec install, that creates the subdirectory structure. So this is all in the book, and we'll assume for some of the live demos we're doing today that we've kind of done these setup steps. So where do things go? The spec directories are designed to basically mimic where things go in your application. So, you know, in app/models, you have your models. In spec/models, you have a spec file for each model, not surprising. Similarly for controllers, we have controller specs. And what about views? Well, we're not really going to do view specs. It's possible to do them, but they're a little bit awkward to write. A lot of what you want to check in a view is stuff that you can actually do in a controller spec, which we'll see an example of today. And besides, we've decided that our approach for writing these user-facing web apps is we're doing user stories to express the parts of the app that the customer can directly interact with. So things that are part of the view, what should be visible in the view and what should be clickable and so forth, we've been using Cucumber for that, and we're going to continue to do so. So for the most part, we're going to restrict our attention in RSpec to writing specs for our models and specs for our controllers. So we'll start with an example of a new hypothetical feature for Rotten Potatoes where we can add movies using information gleaned from TMDB. TMDB is a real site. It is a lot like IMDB, but it's a non-commercial sort of open source one. And the idea is that they have all this information about movies, so if we want to add movies to Rotten Potatoes, why don't we just scrape the information from there? And in fact, when you talked about user stories, there is a step in one of the user stories that says, I'm filling in search terms, I'm going to search for the movie Inception, and then I press this button that says search TMDB. Right? So that's supposed to be the button that will somehow go off to TMDB and see if Inception is in there and pull it back. So the question is, what do we need to do? What kind of code needs to be written, and what kind of testing is entailed by getting this statement that's in red to work? And before we launch into this, remember when we talked about Rails cookery, sort of recipes for doing things in Rails? Remember that when we add any kind of a new feature, that means we need a new route, we need a new controller method, and we may or may not need a new view, depending on whether the feature can reuse an existing view or we have to do something new. But these are the steps we always follow. So let's start with these one at a time. Okay, so this is an idea that we're going to see many, many times. I'll just get you used to the phrase. It's the code you wish you had. It is an immensely powerful idea once you get used to do it. It feels weird to do things this way when you start, but it's very powerful. So we ask ourselves, okay, when the user clicks on that button for search TMDB, we know that somewhere there's going to be a controller action that receives whatever that form submission was. So what should that method do? What should the controller method do that receives the search form? Well, if you just kind of ask, you know, in English, if we wrote down what it should do, we would say, well, let's see. It should call some method, which we haven't written yet, that will actually go out to TMDB and search for the movie. Makes sense. If it finds a movie, it should render some kind of a view with the search results for displaying the match. Again, we haven't created that view, but logically, this is just what we're going to write down that it should do. And we're not going to have time to do step three today, but the sort of the sad path is if it doesn't match, it should redirect to Rotten Potatoes homepage and say, I didn't find anything. And if you look through the example in the book, we actually did the sad path in the BDD chapter. So given that these two things, let's focus on number one and number two, are the things that the controller method should do, here's how we would express, where's my mouse? There we go. Here's how we would express those shoulds using RSpec. And okay, so not a lot going on here, and you know, it's pretty straightforward, right? This is legal RSpec code. Spec helper is just a file that RSpec creates as part of that install step. It does some housekeeping things to make sure everything's loaded up. And we're going to start by saying, what is this test about? Well, we're going to describe the behavior of the movie's controller. And the controller is going to have a lot of different behaviors, but the one that we're concerned about here is the behavior of searching TMDB. So you can imagine, for each different behavior in the controller, as our spec grows, we're going to add more describe blocks inside of this outermost one, describe movies controller. And you can keep nesting. And all I did here was transcribe the three things that we said it should do. So it is actually a method call in our spec. And it takes an argument, which is a string describing what should happen. And as we'll see in a moment, it also takes a second argument, which is a procedure that does that actual test. But for now, all we've done is transliterate. We thought of three things the controller method should do. We wrote those three things in RSpec. This is actually enough to run. And there's a screencast that I encourage you to watch that's associated with the book chapter that does exactly that. All it does is run the three tests. And the tests don't do anything. So RSpec prints them out in yellow. Right? Yellow is not yet implemented, just like it was for Cucumber.